Still hung over from your latest regeneration, your motor skills are in want to calibrate themselves between the hand and eye coordination, and you only remember when you try to manipulate the joystick to navigate and land on comfort and familiarity, but keep overshooting by wide margins. This won't do, so you give up and try to type in something like return to Earth, but the appendages at the end of your hands, oh yeah, the fingers, are too short, too long, too tight, all at the same time, tripping over each other, and when user error just causes it to go haywire at retry and Earth, autocorrect inputs retarieth instead. Not quite Earth, but a close second. Giving up on the keyboard altogether, you slide your hands into the psychic, what was the thing called again? Of course, the circuit controls, and think of things like somewhere you would like to reflect, to reminisce, but the lettering jumbles up and repopulate the destination to Fremisk, which is again not exactly 21st century Earth, but very similar. At least, that's what the historical tourism brooch has claimed anyway. Satisfied that where you're heading is equivalent enough in likeness to your initial aims, you move to sit down, but oh no, the bench is too far away from these controls, or any of them for that matter. You'll have to redecorate. You sink to the floor, but keep your hands in the controls until exhaustion overtakes you, as the last thought to cross your mind is the hope that the TARDIS gleaned enough information from you to land somewhere reasonably safe enough, even if unknown to the local populace. It feels like no more than a blink before you hear the sounds of the landing close to gear engage, and know you must have landed somewhere, if not where you first intended to arrive. A quick peek outside shows a sort of dark blue hue to your present surroundings, if in a forest. Nothing seems to be around, but maybe you'll explore the place later. Or now, and rest after. So off you trudge. The sky is dark and the moonlight bright, but you can tell there's a house or dwelling. And you move to peek through the window, but think, correctly, that the occupants might be asleep. So you creep further around, or at least intend to, when barely have you taken an arbitrary number of steps before you discern a large life form just ahead of you. You decide to back away from it, whatever it might be, since large probably means dangerous, and also when you hear a low guttural growl from that direction. And before you know it, the next thing you hear are wiry fronds as they whip out towards you and forcefully convert you into a literal tree hugger. Strange. This was really Fremisk on Retorath? Where did this ensnarer technology come from? It wasn't due for invention for at least another few thousand years, and by then the municipality isn't referred to as Fremisk anymore. So, how did it get here? But in the meantime, a more pressing need. Saffron. Satisfied that the Proteger traps are sufficiently dealt with, and that your ensnarers and whippersnatchers are camouflaged into their surroundings, looking like epiphytic ivy, hidden behind fronds, or seeming to appear as beehive or wasp nests, you set off and head back to your apartment for a quick nap before your gadget add-ons alert you to an attempted and or successful capture. You head back to your apartment and take a long look at the skull hanging over the fireplace, a stark reminder of why you do what you do, and recall the circumstances under which you discovered it. One leg in a poacher's trap, the head several paces away, and all remaining bones between gnawed through and stripped of skin and flesh while it was still alive and trying to escape. Not that you found it soon enough, but what was left told the story. Forgotten victim of another time, a calm and gentle life of a species cut short to decorate a temporary abode and held at yours to remind you of your motivation. You grab some shut-eye on the bed, or are about to, when your systems inform you of a catch. Humanoid, at least, and a confirmed collection by one of the ensnarers. Excitement floods through you as you set off again, when the other ensnarer is triggered, this time by something much larger, and that will require your immediate attention. Dean, it's no easy task to sneak up on anything, but the bear is distracted from you, and seeing it about to charge at its target, you leap, ninja style, aiming for the back of its head or neck area, hoping to knock it out with a single blow. But even if you had a farmer's tool to use as a weapon with which you are proficient at your disposal, it wouldn't have been enough to put the creature straight to unconsciousness, which means you deal 5 to 7 points damage to it, diverted its focus from even the cow calf it was about to attack, but now you have turned its fury right at you. It bolts towards you at a gallop, and you back away quickly, tumbling to the ground and raising your arm to your face defensively, preparing to be trampled on. Yet just as it slashes with its forepaws, something snares its hind leg from a nearby tree, so it misses the two strikes it aimed to deal against you with its front limbs, and instead sinks its teeth in only a shallow bite on your non-dominant forearm. Not deep enough to even hold you in its jaws, but enough to deal 3 damage total to your strength, coordination, and resolve altogether, piercing through your skin and revealing a glowing bluish-purple light emitting from underneath the surface. More wiry arms whip out at the bear from a nearby tree, ensnaring the lower half of its body and preventing it from reaching you. Safe for the moment, you ignore all of the voices around you. Coming from somewhere nearby is a voice unfamiliar to you, calling out, but you are absorbed as you stare at your arm doing something you have no recollection of seeing before, until you hear footsteps pounding towards you, Saffron's. No time to think, for by now you realize it was the bear's voice that has changed from grunting to recognizable language.
Ugh, it growls. Ugh, are you with the scientists?
And it unmorphs into a scowling teenage girl.